Today we're talking about REITs, how to analyze a REIT, and the differences between REITs and other stocks coming up. Welcome back to the channel, guys. If you're new here, my name is Sean. We talk about saving money, investing, and managing your money here on this channel. So if you're interested, please consider subscribing. So today we're talking about REITs, which is an acronym that stands for Real Estate Investment Trust. They're basically companies that operate real estate as their business. This could be commercial, industrial, residential real estate, etc. The big thing here is that REITs can be publicly traded, which means that you can hold stock or indirectly own this real estate without actually owning the physical property. The other really big thing about REITs that makes them different from other companies is they can give out as much as 90% or more of their operating income in the form of dividends. This is very similar to owning a piece of real estate yourself. That would be like the rental income. So it's important to note there are two types of REITs. One is called an equity REIT, the other is a mortgage REIT or an MREIT. An equity REIT is what I've just said, which is a company that owns and operates real estate as their business model. An MREIT is a little bit different because it's a company that actually loans out the money or executes the mortgages and makes its money off of the interest of those loans. Now let's quickly cover the pros and cons of REITs versus a regular real estate investment. And what I mean by that is like a physical house or condo that you may rent out. So one really obvious advantage would be the ease of purchase and sales. You don't really have to do much to be able to own any piece of real estate. It's got a very low cost of entry. You don't need to have tens of thousands of dollars for a down payment like you would for a physical piece of property. Instead, if you have $100 or $1,000, you can easily get a few shares of a REIT and still be in the real estate game. Another thing here is you can purchase commercial real estate, which is typically a little bit tougher to get into because it's usually a lot more expensive. But if you have a REIT with commercial real estate built in, you can be part of that as well. Another really good thing if you're a dividend investor is that REITs are required to pay most of their net income out in the form of dividends. So when they're collecting the rent and making all the money off their operations, these are supposed to come to you in the form of dividends. This typically makes their dividend yield a lot higher and more attractive than other dividend paying stocks. Another really big advantage of this is liquidity. If you ever needed the cash, you can always sell your stocks very easily and use the money for something else. Versus if you had a physical piece of real estate, selling it is a lot tougher to do, and that would typically involve a lot of fees that you'd avoid having a REIT. Finally, the biggest and most attractive advantage of a REIT over a piece of real estate is you don't have to do any operation or maintenance. That's taken care of by the company. You're basically the owner, you collect the dividends like a rent check, but you don't have to deal with replacing leaking toilets, repainting any damaged walls, or replacing any busted windows. This is great if you're not a particularly handy type of person, or if you just don't want to deal with that. You still get the stability of a real estate investment without any of the headaches. Now let's talk about some of the disadvantages. Well, if you're, let's say, a growth type investor, you could argue that a company that has to pay out most of its net income in the form of dividends is actually a disadvantage because they can't use that money to grow their company and grow the value of their company. A unique feature about the REITs is they're taxed a little bit differently. So when you get your dividends as a shareholder, you actually get taxed on those like they would be regular income. This would be like receiving rent from a real estate property that you owned. You would have to get taxed on that. One thing that I would kind of say is a bit of a disadvantage of a REIT that you get the advantage of on a physical piece of real estate is when you have a tenant, you can develop a relationship with that person, develop a rapport, and you really can figure out if a certain tenant who's coming to rent your place is going to be a good tenant and take care of the place and protect your asset. REITs, of course, operate more like a stock, so you won't be able to have that insight into what's going on in that particular REIT. Their stock price may fluctuate and cause a little bit of stress because the public will react to certain things that happen and sell off at certain times and of course buy back in certain times. Contrast that with what I've found being a landlord is that if you develop a good rapport with a tenant and you find good long-term tenants, you usually can keep them in the condo with a little bit of negotiation, even during turbulent times. So now let's talk about how to properly assess a REIT. The thing we have to be careful about here is that some of the ratios that we typically use to assess a stock aren't going to apply in our case here. And I'm going to get into the math and why that is in a little bit. We also have to remember that these stocks are governed and taxed differently than regular stocks, like the whole 90% of your income going to dividends thing. But the biggest difference that I found here is that because of the way a REIT operates. And what I mean by that is they hold a lot of expensive assets, but make their money off of the way they operate those assets, which is the rental income. You really have to understand how those numbers come out in the balance sheet. You have to understand how depreciation is accounted for. But the other thing too is that you have to understand that balance sheets and income statements don't capture market value. So I'll get into all these differences. For now, I'm going to use a REIT as an example and go through some of the things that you have to look for. The Canadian REIT we're going to assess today is going to be RioCan. According to Wikipedia, RioCan is the second largest REIT in Canada with over $14 billion in assets and over 280 primarily retail types of properties. It also has properties across Canada in most of the urban centers. One of the things that makes RioCan kind of unique is that it's mostly in supermarket and department store type of properties, but it's also kind of interesting because they don't let any one tenant make up more than 5% of its portfolio, which is very good diversification. So with that, we may as well get into the first thing that you should look at when you look at a REIT, which is the types of properties. Understanding the makeup of a REIT are very important, obviously. Like, you want to know if is it made of commercial, industrial, residential, like what percentages. So RioCan, for example, is mostly in commercial real estate, and its commercial real estate is in retail stores. So when you know the makeup of RioCan, how would it be affected by certain scenarios, like in a pandemic? Well, it wouldn't really like a pandemic because a lot of its stores and tenants would have to be shut down. What about in periods of good economic growth? Well, when people have a lot of money and they have a lot of money to spend, retail stores thrive and RioCan would thrive. Now, it is worth noting that RioCan is getting into the residential market, but it's a very small part of its portfolio right now. It's trying to diversify a little bit there. So let's talk about the types of tenants. So like I said, RioCan is mostly made up of supermarkets and department stores, and it doesn't let any one tenant make up more than 5% of its portfolio, whereas other REITs may be very concentrated or have one company that they really like to rent out to, which you could argue makes them less diversified. Being diversified is a great feature in case a certain tenant couldn't make rent. RioCan may be affected by things like store closures. So you may remember a chain from Hudson's Bay Company called Zellers. Zellers used to be a tenant of RioCan. So when Zellers closed down and shut all of its stores down, that affected RioCan. If you're familiar with the story, you'll also know that Target expanded into Canada by buying up a lot of those old Zellers stores and opening them as Targets. That was exciting and good for RioCan, but of course, eventually Target failed in Canada, and that also affected RioCan. These would all be things that you have to keep in mind when you are invested in a REIT. So one last question to ask is about the geographic location of your REIT. How is that made up? How much of it is in urban centers and how much of it isn't? RioCan is concentrated mostly in urban centers, but it's across the country. So Vancouver, Toronto, even here in Calgary, we have RioCan properties. Now, this is a good thing for RioCan because it's been able to make money off of property values in the last few years because real estate has gone up in Vancouver and Toronto, which has been great because real estate in buildings in Calgary has actually not been doing so well the last couple of years. So being geographically diversified has been a good thing for RioCan. Now, the next part of the video is going to get quite technical. We're going to get into the numbers and ratios that you really want to look for. I'm going to go through some of the quarterly statement from Q1 for RioCan to give you some examples. Just a quick reminder to hit the subscribe and the like button if you guys are liking this so far and finding value in it. At the end of this video, I'll also give you guys a couple of REIT ETFs that you guys can look at and research. If you're not so interested in the details like this and you kind of want something simpler, there are REIT ETFs for Canada that are worth looking at. Okay, here we go. So let's talk about funds from operations. Now, I'm going to start by talking about why you shouldn't use a PE ratio for a REIT. So the PE ratio is the price over the earnings per share. That's something we probably all know. Now let's focus in on the earnings per share part. The earnings per share is the net income minus any preferred dividends over the total number of common shares. Now we have to focus in on the net income part. If we dig one step further, the net income is revenue minus the expenses. And here's where REITs are a little bit different. The revenue is essentially the rent that is collected off of all the properties for the REIT. But the expenses will include all sorts of things, including the depreciation. Now a company is required by code to depreciate any assets that they have. But real estate, we know, acts a little bit different than typical assets that another company might have, like a factory or something. So let's say you buy a property for $1 million. Well, if you're a REIT and you're doing your accounting, you have to depreciate some money off of that property every year as you go. So you may say that that property is only worth $900,000 after a year if you choose to depreciate $100,000 off the million. But we all know that property value doesn't work like that. Oftentimes, it actually, the longer that you hold a property, it's actually worth more. Whereas on your books, you're actually making it worth less every year that you hold that asset. So now you can see that the net income number is skewed, which kind of skews your earnings per share, which kind of skews your P to E ratio. So that's why P/Es shouldn't really be looked at when you're assessing a REIT. To get around this, there's something called FFO, which is funds from operations. And what this is adding the depreciation back into the equation. What you wanna see is your FFO going up over time. So let's go to the quarterly statement here from RioCan. We can see that the FFO is going up, and despite having an increase in the number of units, the ratio here is almost the same. So yes, RioCan is making more money from operations than in Q1 of last year, which is great. Now you can take the FFO and put it over the total number of shares to get a price per FFO, which would be like using a P over E, but special for REITs. So how we'd fairly assess the P over FFO for RioCan using this quarterly statement is that we go back to the end of March, we get the share price, which is $15.79, and we divide it by 4 times the per unit FFO that's shown in this quarterly statement, because you have to multiply it by quarter. 1.84. That would give you 8.58 PFFO ratio. And if we compared this to the industry average, which is at about 12 for Canada, it actually would tell you that RioCan is a little bit undervalued when compared to its peers. The one thing to kind of pay attention to though is FFO does miss a little bit. It misses the capital expenditures that are required to get and run a property. So this can be the cash to acquire the building, or even the cash to buy the paint and you know, repaint a bunch of the apartments if you needed to do that. To include those types of expenses, you'll see something called adjusted funds from operations. Now, RioCan does have a section here that specifically states that they do not use AFFO. Instead, they report ACFO, FFO, and NOI, which is net operating income. We'll talk about that next. And they're just saying, in their opinion, those numbers give you the full picture, so they don't do AFFO. Now, jumping down to the ACFO section, you can see it actually captures the maintenance here. So the reason you wanna look at these numbers together, the ACFO, the FFO, and the NOI, is they give you a full picture of the health of the company. And the ACFO will kind of tell you that after they've paid off their capital expenditures, will they still have enough money to pay the dividend? It's almost like a free cash flow per share type of stat, but for REITs. Don't get too hung up by this. If the FFO, the ACFO, AFFO, and NOI are all going up, these are all good things for REITs. So have a look at these numbers together just to get a full picture. Now let's move on to the last number I want to talk about when you're evaluating a REIT, which is the net operating income. But first, we got to talk about why you wouldn't use book value or price to book ratio here. And I'm going to use the example of that house you bought for $1 million. Let's say after 5 years, you depreciated $500,000, 100K a year. On the books, your house would now be worth 500K. But again, we know that's not probably the reality. Well, one way to evaluate any piece of property is to look at NOI, which is net operating income. If you're evaluating different real estate opportunities or trying to compare two different potential rental properties that you're trying to get, yes, you'd want to know the net asset value. You could even figure out a cap rate. Now, we can't do that same sort of calculation with RioCan. It's really difficult to figure out the cap rate that you would use across multiple urban centers and across multiple different types of property. So we're just gonna stick to the NOI for now and talk about the NOI. But what NOI is essentially the income that you collect from renting your properties minus everything except for mortgage payments. So that includes things like property taxes, maintenance fees, repairs, etc., anything that you would need to operate your properties. So let's jump into the quarterly report. I'll just highlight a couple of things here. So you can see that the operating income is $175 million. Remember, these numbers are all in thousands. They go ahead and they take off some of the adjustments here and list an NOI of $173 million. Also jump down to this section here that shows you the split of how much of that NOI is coming from commercial properties versus residential. So this is what I was saying before, where their residential holdings are actually quite small relative to their commercial holdings. Finally, this section here is kind of interesting because it lists the same property NOI, which means This is only numbers for properties that were held in both Q1 of 19 and Q1 of 2020. And you can see here in comparison that the numbers go up. This is actually really good because it means RioCan can produce more money out of the same assets year over year. That was a lot of information, but hopefully I've covered the basics here for you and it's made some sense. Hopefully you guys understand why it's important to understand the makeup of the properties that are in your REITs, why it's important not to look at the P over E ratio, but rather the P over FFO and how that's calculated, the different types and ways you'll see funds from operations like AFFO and ACFO, and finally, why you wouldn't use price to book ratios, but you'd look at the NOI of a REIT instead. Finally, if this is a lot of information and you're maybe not interested in this much detail, but you want to get into REITs, there are two ETFs that I was kind of looking at if that is more your thing. One of them is Vanguard, which is VRE.TO, and the other one is an iShares one, which is XRE.TO. Those two REITs include RioCan along with a lot of other Canadian REITs. I haven't had a chance to research them, but you can look into those if you're interested. By the way, if there's any interest on doing a video about ETFs and how they differ from regular stocks, please let me know in the comments. The next step now is to take this analysis and actually do a comparison between different REITs. There are over 30 REITs in Canada that I could look at. So I'm gonna start to go through, pick the more popular ones. And if you're interested in a REIT comparison video, please also let me know in the comments below. Anyways, guys, thanks for hanging in there. Until next time, have a great week, spread the wealth, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye.